Now, students, let us see some basic elements of the jig sand fixture. Number one is body. So, body of jig and fixture is or should be rigid enough to withstand with the forces acting during the machining operation. It should also absorb the vibration induced during the machining. Then we are having the locating elements, clamping elements. Then for the jig we are having the tool guiding elements, and for the fixtures we are having the tool setting elements. Now let us see the fundamental requirements for locating, supporting and clamping. The very important principle we are using in the locating, that is 3-2-1 principle or method of location. So see here, if you consider this workpiece that we are using in the machining operation as a the body in a free body in a space, then this body is having total 12 degrees of freedom. See, 6 are the degrees of freedom for translation and 6 are for rotation. See here, along this x axis we are having positive x and negative x axis movement, that is the translation. In along y axis we are having this 2 degrees of freedom of translation, and same way in the z axis, that is 2 degrees of freedom for translation. So total 6 translation degrees of freedom, whereas this body or the component can be rotating in clockwise as well as in anti-clockwise direction along all these three axes. So clockwise and anti-clockwise rotation along this x axis, then clockwise and anti-clockwise rotational movement along y axis, and clockwise and anti-clockwise movement along this z axis. So we can say that the free body in a space having the 12 degrees of freedom. Now here we are going to arrest the degrees of freedom for this component by putting these three pins at in this plane. See here, this is pin number 1, 2, 3. This is showing here pin number 1, 2 and 3. This is front view, this is top view, this is side view. Now this, because of these three pins, or we can say the supporting pins, or because of these pads, so when we are using these three pins where on which the component is placed, so because of these three pins the downward movement along this z axis is restricted and object cannot rotate along this x as well as in this y direction. So both these clockwise and anti-clockwise rotations are restricted in x and y axis. So these are total 4 degrees of freedom and one translation movement along this z axis. So in negative z direction the component is not translating. So because of only placing these three pins below this component, we have restricted one translational movement as well as 4 rotational movements along x and y axis. So total, so just introduction of these three pins, we have arrested this 5 degrees of freedom. Now for remaining 7 degrees of freedom, we have the plane perpendicular. See, we are having this plane perpendicular to these three pins. Okay, in that we are introducing these two pins, that pin number 4 and pin number 5. Okay, see here, in the top you are seeing these two pins which is perpendicular to this three pin plane. Okay, now I am having these two pins perpendicular to the three pin plane. The movement along this negative x direction is arrested because of this two pin. Okay, and now we Now also object cannot be rotated along this z direction because of these two pins in clockwise as well as in anti-clockwise direction. So we can say by the introduction of two pins 4 and 5, the object cannot rotate in clockwise and anti-clockwise direction along z axis, and it also cannot move along the negative x axis, isn't it? So total 3 degrees of freedoms are arrested by putting these two pins. Okay, so till now initially we arrested 5 degrees of freedom by these 3 pins. Now to again 3 number of degrees of freedom because of these 2 pins. So totally 8 degrees of freedoms are arrested. Now we are again introducing one more pin perpendicular to this 3 pin plane and 2 pin plane, that is this plane. So this is C, the pin number 6 now we are introducing. Now because of this pin number 6, the object cannot be moved in the negative y direction. Okay, so in that fashion we have arrested total how many degrees of freedom? 9 degrees of freedom we have arrested. And now we are left with 3 degrees of freedom that are still going to be arrested. Now if you consider this part or object is taking for the machining operations, out of these 3 remaining degrees of freedom, 2 degrees of freedom will be used for loading and unloading of the component, and the remaining 1 degree of freedom is used for the tool movement. So during actual machining process, that the 2 degrees of freedom left for loading and unloading is arrested by using the clamping element, and the 1 degree of freedom for the tool movement is arrested by the cutting force acting during the machining operation. So that during the machining operation, all these 12 degrees of freedom will be arrested. Okay, so this is the 3-2-1 principle. 3-2-1 principle, method of location. So we are using the supporting pins or the resting pins or the buttons or pads. First one, we are having this flat or support pin, okay, or flat locator, you can simply say. See here, the type of locator actually used for locating the flat machined faces of the component. This is the flat support pin, okay. Then we are also using the spherical support pin. See, this is the support pin, this is the workpiece, and this is getting into the jig or fixture body. This is the fixture body, this is our pin, this is our workpiece. Now student, let us see some different kinds of the clamps. So first clamp, you will see the strap clamp. See the diagram here, this is the strap clamping. See, this is the part and this is the plate. We are applying the force by this tightening of the stud. This is a heel pin acting as a fulcrum, okay. So the strap clamps are the simplest type of the clamps used in the jigs and fixtures, and there are variety of the designs possible to use this strap clamp, and most of these clamps are based upon the lever principle to amplify the clamping force required. So you can see the typical strap clamp is shown in this diagram. So simply by tightening this stud, the clamping force is transmitted to the part. Heel pin is the fulcrum about which the lever acts while the clamping force is applied onto the part. Okay, so here the actual force is transmitted to the part at the end of the strap as shown here. Okay, the next we are having the screw clamps. So screw clamps are rarely used for the direct clamping operation or purpose. However, practically large number of clamps make use of screws for the purpose of clamping. In the strap clamps, as earlier discussed, these screws are used to apply the clamping force. However, these clamps required a considerable time to get fastened. So here, a much faster way of applying the clamping is to make use of either a swing washer or the C washer if the workpiece has a bore for the clamping. Okay, see, this is a swing washer. This is your fixture body. This is the fixture body. This is the part that you are going to clamp by using this swing washer. Okay, this is the bolt here. You can see here, and this is the retaining screw. A swing washer can be used to clamp a part having the hole. This helps in loading and unloading the part quickly. The only condition is that the hole used for this clamping should be larger than the nut used for the clamping. What is the condition here? The hole used for the clamping must be larger than the nut used for the clamping. A C washer is similar to a swing washer, which remains loose unlike a swing washer. Otherwise, application is very similar. So already I shown you, this is the swing washer and this is a C washer. Okay. Next, we are having this cam clamp. So cam clamps provide the clamping force because of the contour. This is the contour, okay, of the cam surface that comes in contact with the plate used for the clamping. So typical cam clamp design is shown here. See here. So you can notice that a plate is pushed by, this is a plate is getting pushed down by this cam, which is operated by this lever. This lever is used for activating this cam. Okay, so cam clamps are quick in operation. So this diagram is a typical example of a fixture held by this cam clamp. So here you can see this is more stable, and vibrations during the machining do not affect the clamping. This is very stable, and this vibration during machining is not affecting the clamping of this cam clamp. Okay, so next is the toggle clamps. See here, this is the toggle clamp, and so basically these toggle clamps are very useful in the heat exchanger industries, where the heater, radiators and evaporators are made, or condensers. Okay, for making the final assembly for the condensers, that is placing the baffle pins or another assembling units for the condenser, the condenser is held in this fixture by using these toggle clamps. Okay, so the toggle clamps is a quick acting mechanical linkage where two of the element make a toggle action, and toggle clamps are mainly used because of their fast action for the clamping and unclamping, their ability to completely clear the workpiece, and the force fixture amplification possible for the clamping. Okay, then we are having the equalizers. So when the clamping force is to be applied at more than one location, see here, when the clamping force is applied at more than one location, then the equalizing clamps is useful. In this type of clamp, you can, as shown in the figure, the link arm. Okay, this is the link arm. This is link arm system is being used to apply an equal amount of clamping force. Okay, or you can say the link arm system, this link arm system being used to apply an equally divided clamping force to the pair of clamps acting on the same component. The component is same from the two sides, we are clamping this part. Okay, and this is practically used in the conditions where the operator may be denied to ease the access to one or other of the clamps. So in this case we are using these equalizers. Okay, so here the clamping, some clamping examples are over. Okay.